Hi, this is independent journalist Annie Dance. Please subscribe to anniedance.substack.com, my Cops in Congress newsletter, where I work to shine a light on police and policy issues in Western North Carolina and beyond. Some of you may have seen my past reporting about possible terrorism with bridge and critical infrastructure in the United States. Disasters like bridge collapses put transportation agencies' emergency plans to the test. You can scroll back through my past stories to read more about that, as well as many other issues facing the area of Western North Carolina and beyond. Please also follow me on social media at Annie M. Dance on X, formerly Twitter, where I break the latest news, also on other channels as well. Some of you may know, or perhaps not, you're learning today, that I served on the City of Danbury's Commission for Persons with Disabilities for just over 7 years when I lived there. You can learn more on i84danbury.com. That was a volunteer role, and the commission that I served as secretary for, I really tried to emphasize the need for greater transparency and accountability in not only local government, but state government as well. So this I-84 Danbury project, I learned a lot about transportation issues as it not only applies to Connecticut, but really to the country. And so you can read more about me, and that was my former dog who passed away, Harley. But the I-84 Danbury project, the Commission for Persons with Disabilities really wanted to ensure that changes to transportation transit routes, whether they're temporary or permanent due to construction, don't have adverse impacts to not only to the city's disabled population at the time or as construction is underway, but all the time and in all levels of government having that transparency. Again, you can read more about that on i84danbury.com and also look at my LinkedIn at Annie M. Dance, where I have more information about my background. So I'm bringing that up again to give you an update about another critical bridge infrastructure issue and how it's impacting not only immediate family and friends of mine, but hundreds of thousands of people in the Northeast and beyond. On Connecticut Mirror is a nonprofit journalism website. They do great work. So here's a picture they shared from the Norwalk Police Department when a tanker apparently got sideswiped by another car. So they say, are saying, more on that in a minute. And the investigation is ongoing. So with that tanker fire, as you can see from the picture, the bridge itself was unstable and actually had to be taken down. In turn, 95 had to be closed in both directions for the duration. And officials now say they hope to have it open by Monday. A close person to me was in traffic yesterday trying to get home from work for 5 hours to go less than 20 miles. And they ended up going, of course, back roads and going around this. But this is just one example of how a fire can displace many, many people, and construction issues and government transparency becomes a part of that with emergency communications. And what officials say and what they don't say is something I keep a close eye on. So with my background in Connecticut journalism in particular, I have a good sense of sort of the lay of the land. And CSPnews.org, the Connecticut State Police media unit, has their own website. They haven't put out any information directly yet as it relates to the investigation. However, they did speak in the governor's press conference. I'm going to play that in its entirety in just a moment for archival purposes, because there are some very interesting developments, and I will leave it there for now. To emphasize, this is a major traffic artery linking New England with New York, and it can be closed for days. The way around it is to go up other routes through Danbury, which is off I-84 rather than 95, is one route. But a very important point is that the bridge is less than 10 years old. So Governor Ned Lamont on Twitter has posted some information, but now he shifted. If you look on X, formerly Twitter, now he calls it a quote situation, not a crash, a quote situation. That's very telling for me because terrorism in the United States is linked to critical infrastructure, is always a concern. You can read more about terrorism on the FBI's website, but I bring that up because in 2003, the Physical Protection of Critical Infrastructures and Key Assets report done by the Department of Homeland Security speaks directly to key infrastructures and critical infrastructure and key assets, is what they say. I was in college on 9/11 in 2001 in New York City. I got really firsthand account of what first responders are faced with and what those challenges are. So the DHS report lists what they call the protection challenge, including 59, excuse me, 590,000 highway bridges. There's actually more than that now because this is a 2003 report. But keep that in mind with just the sheer volume of what needs to be protected. But again, when something is, anything happens, I'm not saying that this event was terrorism. No one has said that yet or anything like that. But officials say the investigation is ongoing. In looking at this very dense report, looking at keyword search for bridge, I'm reading it states, quote, "We often rely on state and local jurisdictions to protect key national assets, e.g., bridges, tunnels, nuclear power plants, dams, and airports. Conversely, state and local governments request federal resources at times to ensure the protection of their own critical infrastructures and key assets." And they discuss cooperation and many other things. But I bring this up again, stay tuned for the press conference video. It'll all make sense in a minute. It states the loss of a bridge or tunnel can impact traffic along major corridors. However, the potential for national level disruptions is limited. I would argue with this particular instance, it really is more of a national, certainly a regional issue. Before I play all three press conferences for you, I want to play this section of the press conference from yesterday afternoon because of what the governor not only says, but what his demeanor is. Pay close attention.
Talk about the economic impact you expect a multi-day closure to have.
I got it Friday, not our busiest day. You know, I worry about supply chain issues and delays that you may have back and forth.
I'm going to play that for you in its entirety in just a moment. But first, let me highlight the governor's press release and the ticker at the top indicating the traffic alert. So in his press release, he stated he strongly urging all drivers, whether you're a passenger vehicle or commercial vehicle, to completely avoid I-95 this weekend. Again, this happened yesterday. The press conference dated is today. So that's a critical infrastructure lag in communication. And yes, he gave verbal press conferences. However, there needs to be many different levels of communication when you're dealing with this sort of issue, going back to my training, not only in my own personal experiences as a mostly deaf person, but not everyone is going to watch a 25-minute YouTube video about what is going on. Sometimes they want a short, concise answer, say, okay, how do I get home? How do I go to the doctor? How do I go to the grocery store? How do I go from A to B and avoid the situation that's under investigation? So he goes into great detail in the press release. And obviously the first responders are the, what he's calling heroic state and heroic local and state first responders, got the crash cleared and the fire under control yesterday. And I put this out on my Twitter account, but or my ex account. I had many years of experience living and working in Connecticut. I've never heard of ctroads.org until yesterday. It states the public can visit ctroads.org for the latest update through the weekend and view the live traffic cameras in the area. I'm not exactly clear when that went live. It may have been after I moved in 2020. But that's one factor to consider in this is, you know, lawmakers have a habit of doing this, unfortunately, that I've seen, where they say, yeah, we have all these great resources, some you've never heard of. Another quick note, when you go to the governor's YouTube page, the very first highlighted video he has here is from 2 years ago about a Jeopardy champion. I feel like you, as if I were governor, I would put the most pressing matter in the forefront of viewers' faces, but maybe that's just me. Information should be readily accessible to the public as taxpayers and as people who not only, I mean, it's a public safety issue is what it boils down to. So again, it takes some digging to find the video. If you are in playlists, it's not there. If you are in videos and then you finally sort of sort back, you see it. So let's watch the first video and do it in succession, so you have an accurate historical archive of what lawmakers and state officials are, and local officials are saying.
I-95 South, exit 15 in Norwalk. There was a bad crash. It took place under the bridge. It involved a tractor-trailer truck, it involved a fuel truck, it involved a passenger automobile. Thank God, no serious injuries. But it has resulted in the closing of I-95 North and South. And that is incredible in terms of the traffic jams and what's happening there. Here we are at the Emergency Operations Center. They've already sent out a text alert to everybody from Port Chester to Bridgeport. Stay away from that area. We've given a notice to all the trucking companies and others. Take I-87 if you can, or I-84 as alternatives. I-84 is an alternative. Rail is going, or good day to work from home if you have that opportunity. What we're doing right now is we got Rennell Higgins here, and what we're doing with the state police, it's going to be a couple hours to investigate exactly what happened in this accident. You know, there we've got Eversource down there in terms of utilities, and we're also looking at structural damage to the bridge. These are three pieces we have to get clarified before we can figure out what next steps are, how and when we might be able to open up I-95 in one direction, and see what the timing of that is. They'll be here to relay that. I can just tell you that I have talked to Secretary Pete Buttigieg, called immediately, the Fed standing by, Mayor Harry Rilling down in a Norwalk, and what they're doing. We got the operations center set up there. I know what an incredible inconvenience this is for people, and all I can ask you to do is Stay away from that area as best you can. The traffic jams are horrendous. We're on this right now. We're going to have a real update within the next 3 or 4 hours, say at 1:30 or so. We'll know at that point in terms of utility wires and structural, and a better idea of how we can proceed from there. With that, I'd like to introduce somebody you know, Paul Rizzo, who's chief here at Highway Ops, to give you a further update.
Thank you, Governor. Good morning. As the governor stated, traffic is really a nightmare down there. So we encourage the public to avoid the area, utilize I-84 up to the Mass Pike as an alternate. Also use public transportation if possible. We currently have 95 shut down in both directions. We are working with the city of Norwalk to reroute traffic around the city streets, and we have detours set up on I-95 to get the traffic around the incident. CTroads.org is live traffic information that we encourage the public to use. We will be signing on our variable message signs up and down Connecticut, through New York, and through into Rhode Island. We've been in contact with all surrounding states, and they are also using their signs to notify traffic of the incident.
Well, Scott?
Introduce Scott Hill. He's the chief engineer for the Department of Transportation.
Thanks, Paul. Appreciate it. Just want to stress that the bridge is stable. We need to finish the police investigation until to get into actually look at the bridge. We have our state bridge engineer on its way down there. We have people on the site. The bridge is stable and safe. Certainly, we're not going to let local traffic over it. What we have is the utilities hanging down. We have to figure out the status of utilities. Utility companies are on site. We need to get the utilities out of the way. There is damage to the bridge, so I want to make sure everybody knows that. We don't know how extensive yet, but it's not a collapse issue, and the area is safe. Once we figure out how much damage is done to the bridge, gasoline can really heat up and heat the bridge up and cause the steel to deform. Once we figure out everything that's associated with the safety of the traveling public and what we can and can't do, we'll get more updates to you. We anticipate we'll have no more around 1:30, 2 o'clock that the governor said. But at this point, I don't have any more information to provide to you. Thank you.
We're down.
Good morning, everyone. Lots been said already. I will say this. I want to first and foremost thank the first responders this morning that responded to this accident. There is an investigation that is going on right now. The crash analysis investigation team, they are working hard right now along with the truck squad. This is a very complex accident. So they're out there working right now in close contact, in collaboration with the Department of Transportation and DEEP and all of our other partners. So they're out there, they're working right now. Again, there were no fatalities, very minor injuries to report right now. If I could just continue to stress, as the governor has said, use our rails, use alternate routes, I-87, I-84, in those individuals who can, please avoid the area, work from home if you're able to do so. Thank you.
Take questions.
Thanks, everybody.
What's a quick question, Governor, if you don't mind. You know, the catch basin system runs along 95 and drains the Norwalk Harbor. I guess the fact that one of these tractor trailers had 8,500 gallons of gasoline, and how big is the concern that some of that runoff, the oil, the gasoline could eventually end up in the harbor?
I just want to take that.
Yeah, I can address that if you want.
Thank you.
Yeah. Good morning. My name is William Turner. I'm the State Emergency Management Director here in Connecticut. Our Connecticut Department of Energy and Environmental Protection, the State Hazardous Response Team, is on site as well as the local hazmat team. We know there's 8,500 gallons of gasoline on the tanker. About 6,500 gallons have either burned off or run off.
as well as the foam that was used to suppress the fire. That has gone into the Norwalk River, so there's a separate hazardous materials operation to contain that and do a cleanup. So there's a booming operation underway along the Norwalk River to contain and clean up that material, as well as vac trucks are standing by on site to offload the remaining gasoline that remains in the tanker truck.
And sorry, what agencies are dealing with that cleanup right now?
So it's the local hazardous response team, as well as Department of Energy and Environmental Protection, as well as our contractors that they use for the cleanup and mitigation. So,
do we know how many people were in these three vehicles?
Right now, I'm not sure of that answer.
Yeah, we'll have to follow up on that. So, okay. Any other questions?
Thanks, everybody.
All right, thank you.
Follow up on the crash on I-95 in Norwalk that happened at 5:30 this morning, involving a car, fuel tanker, and a tractor trailer truck. And again, thank God, no fatalities, but it has closed down I-95 in both directions. Just got an update on what comes next. The bridge was damaged. The heat from the burning fuel compromised some of the bridge. So that bridge is going to have to come down. That demolition is going to start first thing tomorrow morning, 3 a.m. in the morning. Shears are going to come lift that bridge out. That could probably take 24 hours or a little longer than that. Then they're going to have to take a second look at repaving to make sure that the road is safe and secure. Garrett Ucolito is going to step up. He just told me if all goes well, and I'll monitor this, we should have a two-way commuting back on I-95 as early as Monday morning, which is heroic work. Eversource is here with us as well. There was a line that fed many, many homes. They've kept that going. Nobody was without electricity. And of course, Harry Rilling, the mayor of Norwalk, they're front and center, tell you about the amazing work that our team did across the board responding to this disaster. It is an emergency declaration. I filed that with the feds just in the last hour, hoping to get federal reimbursement for the replacement of the bridge. We ought to get some notification on that in the not too distant future. But first and foremost, what we got to do is get that bridge out of there, get two-way traffic going. The congestion in and around that section of Norwalk is still heavy. We continue to send notices out to everybody to stay away from that. 84, 87, and the Merritt are heavy. There'll be extra rail service as needed if you want to go into New York or get up to Hartford, depending on where you're going from. My recommendation is if you can't stay home, take the train, stay away from the cars. With that, I'd like to introduce to you Harry Rilling, the great mayor of Norwalk.
Yeah, thank you, Governor. And the governor was right. This could have been so much worse. We're very grateful that nobody was seriously injured. We're also very grateful for the response from the state of Connecticut, from our team. Our police officers were out there. Our firefighters were out there and took control of the situation rather quickly. And the response from the state has been really great. So we're optimistic that we're going to get moving forward. Things will get back to normal in Norwalk as quickly as we possibly can. We've scheduled some different staggering work times for people so that they can come in later, maybe go home earlier so we can reduce some of the traffic, but we're also asking a lot of our staff to work from home. So we feel that will keep some of the traffic off the road. We have extra officers on around the clock for the next couple of days. Firefighters will be there, extra firefighters for the next couple of days. So again, we think we've got everything under control, and we're optimistic we're going to move forward with this and get through it. So thank you.
Garrett?
Yep. Good afternoon. So I do want to thank first the City of Norwalk, the Norwalk Fire Department, which is stationed right there, as well as Norwalk PD, and the first responders who really made sure that this was something that could have been much worse. Went pretty seamlessly. Allowed our DOT crews to do their work. The utility crews also, who have been doing work since the morning to ensure it's safe for everyone. This bridge is less than 10 years old, but the damage was pretty severe due to the amount of gasoline that was in the tanker, ignited directly underneath the bridge structure. The steel did begin to overheat and warp. So, and it is a contiguous beam bridge, which means the beams go across both spans of the highway. Unfortunately, it's not able to be safely reopened in either direction underneath that bridge. So we will be mobilizing a contractor to begin work tomorrow. They are in the process of bringing equipment into Connecticut to do the work. This is large equipment that we don't currently stage in Connecticut due to the size of doing this type of demolition. And, you know, we're hopeful that once we can start that work tomorrow morning, we'll be able to have the bridge completely removed. We'll work through the weekend and then hopefully have everything, as long as the weather holds out, have everything reopened for the commute on Monday morning. And I think that's it.
Thank you. I'd also like to thank our partners, Norwalk Police Department, Norwalk Fire, DOT, Deputy Commissioner Bergeron, and Bill Turner for their support through this, and all the others who I haven't mentioned. I'll give you a brief synopsis of what happened today. At about 5:30 this morning, Troop G was made aware of a three-vehicle accident that occurred involving a passenger vehicle and two tractor trailers, one of them being a tanker truck carrying fuel oil. At this point, there were one occupant in each vehicle, so three people involved total. No one was injured, as indicated before, and we're very fortunate there were no fatalities or serious injuries. So we're very happy about that part, at least. No enforcement action has been taken at this time. This is an ongoing investigation, and at the conclusion, we'll have more to report on that. Our response involved troopers from Troop G, the Fire and Explosive Investigative Unit, FEIU, the CSP Truck Squad, as well as the CSP Collision Analysis Reconstruction Squad, also known as CARS. They all responded to the scene and conducted a thorough investigation. We were able to map the scene and do inspections on all the vehicles involved. Our investigation, it included taking measurements, gathering evidence, and interviewing witnesses and observations, as well as taking photographs. We're currently transitioned to a traffic diversion involvement at this point. Our troopers are posted in various locations throughout the diversionary route, and we're encouraging everyone to avoid the area. We're asking you to be patient. Obviously, the traffic is backed up at this time, and we're just looking for cooperation from the public to avoid the area. As the commissioner indicated earlier, we are looking to keep all of the commercial vehicles off of the parkways. We have troopers in the area to prevent them from entering those areas as well. We are out there. We're working to keep the roadway safe, and thank you very much.
Hi, all. The DEEP emergency response unit has been on the scene since this morning. We believe approximately 4,000 gallons of gasoline spilled and was burned away, and approximately 4,000 gallons remained on the truck. That has since been recovered from the truck. The DEEP ERU team has conducted air monitoring with handheld technology, and we believe there's no danger, no impacts to air quality due to the burned gasoline. We also believe there's no impact to the Norwalk River or the harbor, and we are continue to remain on the scene with our spill cleanup contractors removing any gasoline that remains. And the DEEP ERU team expects to remain on the scene overnight.
Any on-topic questions?
The mayor talked about what impact this may have on the school day tomorrow. Are you making any changes? Obviously, the traffic will impact bus routes.
We're looking at that right now to see if the school is going to be closed tomorrow and or Monday, but that decision has not been made yet. They've sent out a voice message to all the parents and looking at perhaps staggering openings if they are going to be open, but that no decision has been made to close the school yet.
Staggered for just your staff, or is it also for major employers in the area?
No, mainly for the students, so because a lot of the parents drive their kids to school, and it can get quite backed up. So hopefully they're going to close the schools, but the superintendent has not made up her mind yet.
Thank Have you reached out to major employers in the area, asking them to somehow maybe allow workers to work from home or staggered?
Yes, we've got everything on our social media pages, yes.
But not like, you haven't reached out to specific
companies? We haven't made telephone calls to everybody, but we have we've sent out a lot of information during the course of the day, keeping everybody posted as to what the current status is. And so we've told them to keep people home, let them work from home if they can. So
95 will be closed in both directions until at least Monday morning. That's your best estimate, Garrett?
Yeah, it's not safe based on our engineer's review. It's not safe to allow any traffic to pass underneath the bridge in either direction. The entire bridge needs to come down. In order to do that quickly, it needs to be, you know, no traffic of any kind to get this large equipment in there, completely remove it. If we were to allow traffic on one side, even if it was safe on one side, in order to remove the bridge, you need to take the whole thing out. You can't just leave half the bridge in place.
Is this one of the bridges that was basically dropped into place overnight with the new construction technique? Or?
No, it was not accelerated bridge construction. It took a few years.
Does that carry? What route does that carry across?
Fairfield Avenue across the top, local road. So.
It's a local road, but it's a state bridge because it expands. So.
Yeah.
What's the plan for that? Are you going to be putting in a temporary bridge in the meantime?
No, definitely not a temporary bridge. It's not possible to put a temporary bridge over I-95 that would traverse that long of a distance across that multiple lanes. So we will have to build a new bridge. So we will, as soon as we remove it, we can begin the inspections of the pier in the middle and the median. If that pier is safe and solid and there was no damage to the pier, that will make life a little bit easier to do a complete rebuild where we can just procure new steel, which there is quite a long lag time for steel right now, several months. But, you know, the goal is if the pier is safe, if the abutments on either side of the bridge structure are safe, it will make life easier for us to be able to build a new bridge in place over the course of a year. So,
And I'm sorry, what is a pier?
It's the concrete in the middle that holds up the bridge.
Can you elaborate on the additional Metro North services? Will this be all entire weekend? Is this just during peak hours? When will we see more trains?
So right now, no trains will be definitely added to the schedule. Metro North has crews on call, and we've mobilized additional equipment. So Metro North is going to monitor in real time. The good thing is tomorrow, Friday, is the lightest day of the work week for Metro North travel. So we don't expect any problems on a Friday to absorb increased capacity. Weekends have been busy. So we're going to monitor in real time what the passenger load is of those train sets. If Metro North needs to add additional train sets due to capacity issues, they'll have the ability to quickly mobilize and add those train sets on or add additional cars on.
And on a normal day, what is the traffic volume?
That part of 95. Average daily traffic volume through there is about 160,000 both directions combined. So,
would you describe those diversion plans for commuters and truck operators? Where are they going to be diverted to, and how could that impact potentially local traffic?
Yeah, so I-95 northbound, it's closed at exit 14, so you'll be diverted off exit 14 and you'll re-enter at exit 15 northbound. When you're going southbound, you'll be diverted off of exit 15 onto West Street, and then you'll get back on at exit 14 southbound. If you're in a passenger vehicle, you could get onto Route 7, and if you were going to travel up, you could go all the way up to the Merritt Parkway, which would be exit 3. All commercial traffic would have to avoid exit 3, and they could get off either the West Street exit, exit 1, which is a Belknap Avenue, exit 2, or the Grist Mill. Not as much as you would think. People have been complying with that, and we do appreciate the buy-in from the public on that.
What efforts are being done to get the word out about the truck diversion route, particularly since it's going to require people to take several routes starting in New York? I'm assuming there's cooperation with New York to have signage and alert trucks.
So you want to take that, Bill?
Yeah.
Good afternoon. I'm Bill Turner, the State Emergency Management Director. So one of the tools we're utilizing is what we call wireless emergency alerts. So since this morning, we've had that in place, and that will remain in effect. And we have a message telling all traffic starting at the New York border down near Port Chester all the way up to Bridgeport and north along Route 7. Anyone that drives into that area in that geographical footprint will receive a wireless alert on their cell phone advising them to avoid the area. We're going to keep that active throughout the night into tomorrow, continue to evaluate how long we need to keep that in place. But we already see that that's working, as we're seeing the traffic coming out of New York has already lessened. So it seems that the message is working as designed and getting people to take the diversion route, which we do have highlighted, next to me here, and we'll continue to share those maps, really encouraging anyone coming out of Boston how to get around this incident, as well as coming out of New York. And then if anyone does find themselves in the immediate area of the incident, how to quickly navigate that diversion plan that the colonel just spoke of. So, and Commissioner Kitt.
And one thing that I think works well is all of our state DOTs communicate in operations like this. So we've been in communication all the way down to Delaware, all the way up through Massachusetts, telling, and they've been putting message boards in their states, telling truckers before they even come to Connecticut to avoid I-95 so that they can go around, get on 684-84 or 87 to 84. So we don't want them to hit Connecticut and then get stuck in the traffic on I-95. So that communication has been pushed out to all the state DOTs on their overhead VMS boards, also through a system that we're able to push messages into the commercial vehicle cab cars, cab signals. So they get alerts in their cabs through TomTom driveways and other commercial equipment they have.
Governor, should you talk about the economic impact you expect a multi-day closure to have?
They got it Friday, not our busiest day. And I worry about supply chain issues and delays that you may have back and forth. I think it will definitely impact the local merchants in a variety of different ways. I think broadly for the state, it'll be a lot less of an economic impact. Bob Duff, if we have a vote on the budget on Saturday, I recommend the guys from Norwalk leave a little early.
Did you know miles wise, time wise?
I don't know, but it's going to be a longer route for them. There's a reason they take 95 in the first place. You know, the time is money for them in the commercial trucking space, so they're going to go the fastest route. So if they were taking 95 to begin with, was going to be the fastest route for them. Now it will be a diversion, added time and cost, but it's going to be much less time than waiting to get through the 95 detour. So,
Governor had mentioned electric utility lines running through there. We had also heard there was gas. Is there both running under there? Was that, like, were there other utilities that were impacted, or is it just electric?
Gas is actually going to come.
Sorry, any other question?
The governor talked about the electrical running through there. We had also heard there was gas lines. Were those impacted at all?
Yeah, Eversource does not have any electric facilities on the structure. It's only a 12-inch steel gas line. We're working and have not lost any customers. We're isolating that as we speak, so the demo can be conducted in the morning.
Earl, are you concerned about increased incidents of road rage or people who are frustrated by confused by these delays?
I'm concerned about it, but we have troopers out there ready to respond. Should anyone have any issues, I encourage you to call 911. We have troopers ready to respond. We have extra patrols out there to mitigate that.
Hearing no further questions, thanks. Thank you, guys. One good one.
Thank you.
Great response.
My life will not be a little
moving forward. I want to just thank everybody that took a part in this and made sure that we were going to get this done. So I do want to introduce the governor of our state, Governor Ned Lamont.
All right, well, thank you, Mayor Rilling and everybody, and I'll just reiterate what Harry said. Just imagine, it was 5:30 yesterday morning when a passenger car came in, sideswiped the tractor trailer as well as a fuel truck. The fuel truck catches on fire. fire burning underneath the bridge. The bridge is found to be incredibly unstable. And here we are a little more than 24 hours later, and that bridge is going to be down very soon. The shears are coming in, lift off the final piece of this, get the asphalt back in place, and hopefully, a lot of links in the chain, we get an I-95 going in both directions on Monday. Big hats off to the people standing behind me, the folks who have been here since 5:30 yesterday morning, here 5:30 again this morning as we start getting this bridge replaced and what we got to do going forward. You know, I've been on the phone with, Pete Buttigieg. I'm here with Senator Blumenthal, who's got some announcements in terms of what we're doing to make sure we get federal support. We declared our emergency declaration yesterday. Hopefully that puts us in the front of the line, make sure we get the federal support we need. But from the bottom of my heart to all the contractors, the fire department, the team you've got here, Harry, making sure this works. My only advice to you, because it was pretty choppy getting down here, is stay away. Stay away from this area for at least another 72 hours. Take the train, stay home. I think you're going to save yourself a lot of stress. Dick?
Great. Thanks, Governor. Thank you to Mayor Rilling. And I want to add my thanks to the Norwalk Police and Fire. They have been absolutely magnificent. And to the State Police as well. And all of the state DOT cooperating with the federal DOT. And the people of Connecticut should know that the cost of this repair is going to be borne by the federal government. The money is there. It doesn't have to be appropriated. Doesn't have to be authorized. There is federal highway administration money there for emergency relief designed to meet exactly this need. And we are going to be writing as a delegation to the Federal Highway Administration, which is part of the federal Department of Transportation. We're going to be demanding money to cover all of the costs, probably in the tens of millions of dollars, at least $20 million. And we have every assurance that the Department of Transportation will provide this emergency relief. So none of the cost is borne by Connecticut taxpayers. The Federal Highway Administration has money already appropriated for exactly this kind of purpose, and it's used elsewhere in the country. Connecticut should have its fair share. In the meantime, the real workload burden is going to be borne by the contractors and the Department of Transportation of the state of Connecticut. And as the governor said, if you're in this area, there's no good way to get there from here for right now, and maybe for a little bit of the foreseeable future. There can be a lot of trucks trying to find a way around this bottleneck. And of course, the trucks can't use the Merritt. So they're going to be on local streets. Think Mianus River Bridge and the kind of traffic we saw at that time. Federal money is going to be there to cover the financial costs, but the inconvenience and the other burdens are going to be borne by the people of this area. I live here, so I go to Hartford every day that I'm in Connecticut or on those roads, and I'm going to be trying to accommodate my schedule, for example, leaving a little bit earlier in the morning, say at 6:30 instead of 7:30, and as I did this morning, there was no traffic. I can tell you that there are ways around it, but just be advised that there's going to be a little bit extra inconvenience. Thanks.
Yep. Good afternoon. So, Connecticut Department of Transportation, working with the contractor on seeing Yonkers construction, is currently in the midst of demolishing the existing bridge that is out there, bridge number 55. Quite a lot of work has been done in just the past few hours. Once the concrete is removed from the structure, we have equipment on the way, large shears that will be able to remove the actual beams from the bridge. Once that is completed, we will then begin to remove debris, and then we will be able to resurface the roadway, hopefully opening up in time for rush hour morning traffic Monday morning. do want to thank all the first responders, law enforcement, who have been providing traffic control to allow us to do our work. But my request to the public would be to please be patient. We have seen instances of people getting frustrated with the queues of traffic, trying to get around those crews, actually entering into our work zones, putting contractors and DOT workers at risk. So I need people to be patient, try and avoid the area, and encourage people to take the train into Norwalk to visit some of the restaurants and bars, if you can, patronize the businesses who might be impacted. And with that, I'll turn it back to the governor or the mayor.
Sir, can you identify yourself really quick?
Yes, Garrett Euclido, I'm the commissioner of the Connecticut Department of Transportation.
Any questions?
Commissioner, a couple of questions. The state of the road, I-95, do you have to do a lot of milling and repaving there?
So we can't entirely inspect it until the demolition is complete. We think we'll just have to do a little milling and resurfacing on at least one of the sides. Yes, that should.
Yesterday about the pier in the middle that holds the thing up. Yeah. Have your engineers been able to take a look at it? Do you know if you're going to be able to reuse that?
We won't be able to reuse the pier. We're right now determining whether we will take it down in the next couple of days or wait until the full reconstruction to take it down.
Okay, and a number of us have done stories north and south of this point, Connecticut being innovative with the use of ABC, the accelerated bridge construction. Is this a candidate for ABC replacement?
It doesn't make sense to do it in this location because to do an ABC project, accelerated bridge construction project, you need some laydown area to build the spans to be able to roll it into place. This area is very developed. There's no real location to be able to build on site and roll it in. But we don't expect disruption during the full rebuild. It could be like any other highway project where we would just take a lane on either side to put the beams in place. And then once the beams are in place, our construction administrator has a lot of experience in this front. You know, then the work occurs above the roadway once that's done.
And finally, when you reopen the road on Monday, do you anticipate having all travel lanes open, or do you think there will be some lane closures?
Our goal is all the travel lanes.
And what about our keeping an eye on the weather? I understand Sunday and everything's rain.
Yeah, that is the one factor we're keeping an eye on. You know, repaving during extreme wet weather is. You know, not possible. So we're just going to wait and see what that weather looks like. But our goal is still to have everything open Monday morning.
How long does that reconstruction process take?
The hard part is doing demolition. So once that's done and we have a blank slate, it can take a little over a year is the goal.
The fact that this bridge is less than 10 years old, you basically still have the plans and
we do have all the plans, but we are going to look at the load ratings because federal requirements change over time. So there have been changes in some of the federal requirements on load ratings since that bridge was the design plans were finalized in 2011 to now. So we're going to need to wait and see what those changes have been.
Mayor, really, your thoughts about Fairfield Avenue being closed for a year?
Well, you know, it is what it is. We have to live with it. It's not ideal, but we understand that. It was closed before when they were reconstructing the bridge 8 years ago. It'll be a little bit of an inconvenience. And as you heard the commissioner and the mayor, the governor and the senators talk about driving around Norwalk, it's going to be an inconvenience that we're going to have to deal with.
Regarding the crash, we're not going to have the
State Police did that investigation, you know, yesterday morning, and we'll get the results of that very soon, but nothing to report yet.
And I might just say, we're looking into the economic effects of businesses. This could be a real hardship for some of the businesses. We're looking at the possibility of loans that might be available, obviously at minimal interest from either FEMA or the SBA. We're exploring that possibility in disaster cases where there have been economic impacts of natural disasters. Often those kinds of loans are available. We're looking into the possibility that here some of these businesses may be impacted and there may be loans at minimal cost to them.
Commissioner, in the last 10 years since that bridge was rebuilt, has a lot changed in terms of bridge construction, technology, use of computer-aided design? I mean,
there have been quite a lot of advances there, you know, things such as what's called the digital twin, where you have a digital 3D model of the, what you're going to be building. That's something that is now being heavily utilized in the state DOT world. Also use of drones on the before you go to the construction side. In this instance, a lot of those may not be necessary because we've already, you know, advanced quite a bit in this process where we have some designs already. We're going to dust those off, see what needs to be updated. But, you know, the hope is that advances since the last designs were finished in 2011, it might be a little bit easier.
When is that big piece of equipment going to come in to remove the bridge?
Yeah, so we'll have a couple. They're called shears to be able to cut the beams. Those are on their way right now, and they should be arriving this afternoon. And then should begin their work tomorrow morning to begin once everything's removed from the bridge and the beams can be begin to be cut down early tomorrow morning is the hope. So, New York, Long Island.
Besides Yonkers, are there other contractors involved too?
We do have contractors working with Yonkers, like AI.
Breeze is the subcontractor.
Breeze is a subcontractor from New York.
The shears, how long is that in time frame are you expecting that to take that project part?
Well, that should only take about 24 hours.
So thinking now, because we're in an apparatus building, what about the impact of first responders and going to calls for the next year?
You want to take that?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah,
there you go.
Yeah. Thank you. That's a good question. We've been through this before when they put the bridges up. So as far as an inconvenience, that's exactly what it is, but it doesn't really affect our response. We have bridges on the east side and the west side, and we'll just go around the block. So we could live with it.
As Chief Gatto said, we've coordinated with NOAA Combined Dispatch before with this exact plan, so we'll have no issues at all responding to this side of town. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
That was famous.
Where are we? All these 100-year-old friends.
This.
At the end of that press conference there, you may have heard what was muttered and caught on the hot mic, saying that was pretty painless, well done, at the end of the press conference. I find that to be controversial because it could be perceived as dismissive or trivializing the issues discussed. It's a serious topic. Press conferences often address important, sometimes sensitive topics, such as important public safety and other vital information. If the official's tone seems too casual or lighthearted, it could come across as insensitive or downplaying the gravity of the subject matter. If you say something like, that was painless or well done, it could be seen as implying the issues discussed weren't significant. I find this to be frustrating as a journalist, but I think it's even more so for the public who want these matters to be taken seriously. In the context of a serious issue, the dismissive comment by an official could be seen as disrespectful or out of touch with the public. I think it could also be interpreted as having lack of empathy or understanding of the challenges being faced by the community. They can say they're going to leave early all they want, but that really is meaningless when it comes to the gravity of the situation. So these comments and what these officials say and don't say are vitally important to keeping accurate accounting of, which I'm aiming to do here with this archive and this information. Again, I am an independent investigative journalist. These are public statements by public officials. They need to be held accountable. If you go into and read the letter that the governor sent, it's archived through like five different clicks on the portal ct.gov website, the state of emergency, Governor Lamont and loves his states of emergency. As you may recall, in COVID, it was one of the last states in the entire country to end their state of emergency. But this is a vitally important issue. So in that, it discusses the immediate need, and it states that the residents of all along the Eastern Seaboard are impacted, including North Carolina. So keep that in mind, and I'm going to be keeping a very close eye on what develops. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.